Year 4, Part 2. December was a hard month for Pat. Life seemed to drag itself along like a wounded animal. Winter set in early. It snowed continuously for 3 weeks. Little storm demons danced in the yard and whirled along the lanes. Everywhere were huge banks of snow, white in the sun, pale blue in the shadows. There were quaint caps of it on the unused chimneys. It was piled deep in the secret field when Pat went to it on snowshoes. One felt that spring could never come again, either to Silverbush or one's heart. On a rare fine day, the world seemed made of diamond dust, cold, dazzling, splendid, heartless. There was the beauty of winter moonlight on frosted panes, and chill harpings of wind beneath cold, unfriendly stars. At least, Pat felt they were unfriendly. Things were not the same. Always between her and Ray was the coldness and shadow of a thing that must not be spoken of, that must be forgotten. Ray chattered continuously of surface things, but in regard to everything else, she preserved a silence more dreadful than anger. There was always that false gaiety, good-humored and polite. To Pat, that politeness of Ray's was a terrible thing. They might have been strangers. They were strangers. Ray seemed to have locked her heart against her sister forever. Just before Christmas, Ray announced carelessly that she had been awarded a scholarship, a 3-month course in nature study at the OAC in Guelph, and meant to take advantage of it. The trustees had granted her leave of absence, and Molly MacLeod of South Glen was to take the school for the 3 months.
"That is splendid," said Pat, who knew Ray must have been aware of the possibility of this for weeks, and had never said a word about it.
"Isn't it?"
Ray was brightly enthusiastic. She was very busy during the following days preparing for her going and talking casually of plans. She was all radiance and sparkle, and teased mercilessly because Judy was afraid she would learn to smoke cigarettes at Guelph. But she never consulted Pat about anything, and when Pat, at Christmas, gave her a crimson kimono with darker crimson mums embroidered on it, remarking that she thought it would be nice for Guelph, Ray merely said, "How ripping of you! It's perfectly gorgeous!" But she never told Pat that Uncle Horace had sent a check for a new coat, and when she bought a stunning one of natural leopard with cuffs and collar of seal, she showed it to Judy and Mother and the aunts, but not to Pat, merely left it lying on her bed where Pat could see it if she chose. Pat was too hurt to mention it. When Ray went away, looking very smart and grown up in her leopard coat and little green hat tipped provocatively over one eye, she kissed Pat goodbye, as she did the others, but her lips merely brushed Pat's cheek, and most of the kiss was expended on air. Pat watched her out of sight with a breaking heart, and cried herself to sleep that night. The loneliness was hideous. She couldn't bear to look at the bed where Ray had slept, or the little old bronze slippers Ray had danced in so often, but thought too worn to take to Guelph. One of them was lying forlornly under the bureau, the other under the bed. Pat got up and put them together. They did not look quite so forlorn and discarded then. True, there had been no real comradeship between her and Ray for weeks, though they had shared the same room and sat at the same table. But now that Ray was gone, it seemed as if hope had gone with her. Pat was too proud and hurt even to talk it over with Judy. It was the first time she had not been able to talk a thing over with Judy. That cold, indifferent goodbye kiss of Ray's, little Cuddles, who used to put her chubby arms around her neck and love her so hard. Pat couldn't bear to think of it. She looked at her new calendar hanging on the wall, a very elaborate affair which Tillytuck had given her. She had always thought a new calendar a fascinating thing, yet with something a little terrible about it. It was rather fun to flip over the leaves and wonder just what would be happening on this or that day. Now she hated to see it. There were 3 months to be lived through before Ray would come back. And when she did come, would things be any better? Bold and Bad padded into the room and jumped on the bed. Pat gathered him up into her arms. Dear old cat. He was still left to her, anyhow. And Silverbush, whatever came and went, whoever loved or did not love her, there was still Silverbush. Nevertheless, Pat looked so haggard and woebegone at breakfast that Judy wished things not lawful to be uttered concerning go-preachers. During that dreary winter, Pat's only real pleasures were her evenings at the longhouse. Suzanne and David were so kind and understanding, especially David. I always feel so comfortable with him, thought Pat. And her letters from Hillary. One of his stimulating epistles always heartened her up. She saved them up to read in the little violet blue hour before night came, the hour she and Ray had been used to spend in their room, talking and joking. She always slept better after a letter from Hillary, and very poorly after a letter from Ray. For Ray wrote Pat in regular turn, flippant little notes, each seeming just like another turn of the screw. They were full of college news and jokes, such as she might have written to anyone, but never a word about Silverbush affairs. No reference to home jokes. Ray kept all that for her letters to Mother and Judy. When I see the evening star over the trees on the campus, I always think of Silverbush, Ray wrote to Judy. If Ray had only written that to her, thought Pat. Pat sent Ray a box of goodies, and Ray was quite effusive. No doubt it's a youthful taste to be thinking of things to eat, she wrote back. But how the girls did appreciate your box. It was really awfully kind of you to think of sending it.
As if I were some outsider who couldn't be expected to send her a box, thought Pat.
I hear that Uncle Tom has had the mumps, and that Tillytuck is still howling hymns to the moon in the granary. Also, that Sid is still dancing attendance on May Binney. She'll get him yet. The Binneys never let go. Do you suppose North Glen will faint if I appear out in a bright yellow raincoat when I come home? Or one of those long, slinky, sophisticated evening dresses? Silverbush must really wake up to the fact that fashions change. I had a letter from Hillary last night. It's odd to think this is his last year in college. He has won another architectural scholarship and is going to locate in British Columbia when he is through. He thinks he will be able to get out here to see me before I leave. Hillary had not told Pat about any of his plans. The announcement of Mr. Wheeler's marriage was in the paper that day. Judy viciously poked the sheet that bore it into the fire and held it down with the poker. 2 weeks later was the end of March, and Judy was getting her dye pot ready, and Ray was coming home. Pat found herself dreading it, and broken-hearted because she was dreading it.
"What is the matter with Pat this spring?" Long Alec asked Judy. "She hasn't seemed like herself all winter, and now she's positively moping. Is she in love with anybody?"
Judy snorted.
"Well, then, does she need a tonic? I remember you used to dose us all with sulfur and molasses every spring, Judy. Perhaps it might do her good."
Judy did not think sulfur and molasses would help Pat much.